Squirrels. Squirrels, and depending on how you feel about them, you may be thinking, yay, these lovely cute little critters, or you may be thinking of rats with fluffy tails. But however you feel about them, I'm going to be talking about the maths of species conflict. There are two species of squirrel in Britain. There's the red and the grey. And the grey have supplanted the red and pushed them out primarily up to Scotland and some of those parts in North Wales. Dominantly, if you see a squirrel in the UK, it's going to be a grey squirrel. So how do we understand that? Well, we try and write down interaction equations between the two squirrel populations. We're going to be looking at the grey squirrel and the red squirrel population, and we're going to write down some equations that tell us how they interact. Grey squirrel population changes with time, so T is going to be time. The red population is going to be changing over time. Now, we can include space in this and understand how they were pushed further north and further north, but generally we don't really need to. If you're considering an island, we can just consider how that conflict occurs. So we'll throw away space for now and just consider an island of grey and red squirrels. And what we say is that the grey squirrels undergo binary competition, as do the red squirrels. In fact, the equations I'm going to write are going to be pretty damn similar. So all this says is that the population of squirrels grows proportional to how many squirrels there are, but if there are too many squirrels, they compete. And that could be for resources, partners, homes, nuts, can be for anything, but there's some competition keeping their population finite. Same with the red, exactly the same. But we're going to add in a new term, and we're going to add in alpha GR here and beta GR here. Minus alpha GR is the competition of the grey and the red for the grey squirrels. Beta GR is the competition for the grey and red squirrels for the red. It's how they interact. So it's always going to be a negative effect. The competition is never going to help the species. But the size of alpha and beta are going to be how good they are at competing. Now that's a lot of maths, I fully understand that. But one thing I love about mathematical biology is that you get so far and so much information from drawing pictures. A picture is worth a thousand words. And so if you can draw a picture that immediately shows the answer to these equations, you can convince a parliament of policymakers to how to save the red squirrel. So what we're going to do is we need to understand a little idea called a nulcline. The nulclines in this are where the populations aren't changing. Okay, so when we set these to zero, that's when the nulcline is. So we set this left-hand side to zero. We have some conditions linking the red and green, the red and grey, which will give us some curves. And they are the nulclines. So in this first case here, we have G equals zero. When G is equal to zero, that will be satisfied. Or we could have 1 minus g minus alpha r equals 0, when g t equals 0. That's the grey squirrel nulcline. This one, if r is 0, that's also satisfied. But we could have 1 minus r minus b g equals, and that's the red squirrel nulcline. Now what we can do is rearrange these, and what we find is if we put grey as the dominant population, we can rearrange this to 1 minus alpha r, and this one would be then g is equal to 1 minus r over beta. Okay, so they're just two lines. So I have four nulclines, two for each population. One g equals 0 and g equals 1 minus alpha r for the grey squirrels, r equals 0 and g equals 1 minus r over beta for the red squirrels.
Okay.
Lines. So g equals 0 is a fantastic line to draw, as is r equals 0. And these are just two lines connecting g and r, g and r. But there are different ways that these lines can cross. Understanding how they would cross predict what will happen with these populations. You can do all this analytically. You can work it out with numbers and show that all of this is concrete. But when you can draw pictures, why would you do that? So I'm going to be looking at my population in terms of two axes. We're going to have the red population along the x-axis and the grey squirrel along the y-axis. You'll notice that these two lines are negative. So as I increase r, g decreases. So for the grey squirrels, we have g equals 0. So this is one nulcline. Along there, gt equals 0. And the other line is somewhere, don't really care, it's just a line. Now, for the red squirrels, we have r equals 0, that's up here, and then again another line. But does my line cross like that? Does it cross like that? Does it cross there? Or does it cross like that? There are four different cases we have to consider, and they each tell us something different about what could happen. This one is the red squirrels along there is 0. And so, let's put the red nulcline underneath the grey squirrels. And along that line, r dot is equal to 0. I'll quickly explain this. A dot can stand for rt. Just a simple way, so I don't have to keep writing t. And so along here, we have g dot equals 0. Now, we could draw lots of more detail on here. But from this setup of the nulclines, the g is dominating. the dynamics. And the other thing we can say is, where is the system going to go? I will pick a point in here, and that will be a setup of the system. The system, under these equations, will drive that trajectory to a place where it will stop moving. Where could it go? Well, if it stops moving, then both the red stop moving in time and the grey stop moving in time. So wherever a red and a black line cross, that's a potential place where this trajectory could end up. Okay, so there are three places it could end up. It could end up at 0, 0. That's the case when my red and grey populations are extinct. It could end up here. That's where my grey population is extinct and my red survive. It could end up here. My red died out, but my grey have survived. And in this setup of the Nork lines, it's actually the grey that's going to dominate. So all of my trajectories are going to end up being pushed towards this one. And the reason comes from this line being the first one out. It's dominating the system. The grey squirrels are outcompeting the red. Okay, and that's why this line is the furthest out. Right, so that's one setup we could have of these Nork lines. The grey line does not have to be the furthest one out, because the red line is furthest out. So the, guess what? The red squirrels will dominate, and they will head to this steady state. Why don't we ever stop at 0, 0? Because there's a positive population four. So no matter how small your population start, they will grow. So what we say is this is an unstable equilibrium. If we have no squirrels to start with, we never will, but any small amount of squirrels will push us away. So it's really these two that we have to worry about. So what will happen here is the population will tend to this one. It's because that the red Nork line is furthest out, so the reds are dominating the system, they're outcompeting the greys. Now, okay, it tells us that can happen, but that's obviously not the case that's happening in the UK, unfortunately. Again, that's not the only two ways that this could happen. What's another way that they could cross? Well, we could have grey squirrel Nork line there and the red squirrel Nork line there. This is one of the interesting cases, because again, you'll have the cases of everything extinct, red extinct, grey extinct, but now they're crossing at a new point we didn't have previously. So we have a fourth solution. And now in this setup, we actually find that this state here is stable. It's attractive. Because there's no dominant pairing, we don't kill off either of them. They can actually survive in harmony. So the trajectories will push the populations. Again, unfortunately, not how the UK is working out. So, but we can say what's happening in this case is alpha and beta in our equations initially are small. We can say that, because what's really happening is they're not really competing. We could take this to a limit and say alpha and beta are zero. They're really not competing at all. They're living together, but they're each doing their own thing. And in that case, what you find is they quite happily live together. You have your nuts, I'll have mine, and we'll all live happily families. Small competition. What happens when competition is big? Well, this gives us our fourth case. So there's the grey squirrel and this is the red squirrel. Again, we have that fourth one, but we've swapped the Nork lines. So we have there, 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 and our fourth one. Because we've swapped the Nork lines, we are now in the case when the competition is very big. Both are trying their best. And in this case, the steady state isn't stable anymore. It's unstable. So in this case, we have the four points again that we're going to head to, but this time it's pushing us away from the state. So our population out here will push us to the case where the red has died out. And if we start out here, it will push us to the case where the gray has died out. And again, if we start with a small batch of both, we'll be sucked in. Now, which one will we choose all depends on where we start. So it's a very hard thing. You need to know what your setup is to know where will the red win out or will the gray win out. Now, of course, in Britain, unfortunately, we are in this case here, where the greys are easily dominating the reds and the greys are winning out. But from that piece of mathematics, we get to see the whole idea of what biology can produce. We can produce cases where you're interacting peacefully, you're interacting aggressively, you're out trying to outcompete each other. You're trying to outcompete each other separately. That one of the cases, that you're not even trying. You know, the greys are really winning over the reds. Here, the reds are winning out over the greys. But through that one equation, we can see the entire plane of all mathematical competitive.
You said we're now in this situation here. Is it possible it started in that situation there, though?
I mean, the greys have always dominated the reds. They're better hunters, they're bigger, they're more aggressive. But the question is, could we ever move it to say this? Or perhaps, you know, if we want to eradicate the grey, I'm going to sit on the fence, I love all animals, but do we want to eradicate the grey? Or do we want to allow them to live in harmony? Well, in that case, that tells you exactly what you need to do. You need to change the dynamics. You need to change their competitive abilities. Either you swap the null clients around, you make the reds more aggressive in some way, or you move it such that they don't compete. You give them two different food sources, okay? Greys love sausages, and the reds love peanut butter. If you could find something like that, then they could both survive and be happy. But unfortunately, just because we can say how it can work doesn't mean it's possible to push it in this direction.
Tom, some of this kind of feels like just kind of stuff that's quite obvious and intuitive, and you've really complicated it and formalized it with graphs and equations, where I could have told you the greys are better hunters, and therefore, why do you need this mathematical formalism for things that seem intuitively obvious when you think about them?
Yep, no, A, it gives you a way of framing that argument, because there are a lot of arguments, and you could say, greys are better hunters. Okay, well, is that the reason? I haven't put the fact that they're the better hunters in here. I've said that they compete better than the reds. That could be for mating reasons. It could be for roosts where they live. All I'm saying is they're competing better. So you've specified one point. I've taken out a strategy. Another thing it gives us is being able to see, well, what is the strategy space that we're working in? You again have said, okay, the greys have won out. That's the case we're dealing in. But that doesn't tell us how we get to the greys and reds living together, or the reds surviving. This comes down to a question about the pandemic that's happening a lot. Why do we need mathematical modelers? We can see how many people are ill. We can see how many people are dying. We've got the data. That's true. But it doesn't tell us what the best route of getting out of this mess is. And that's what maths gives you. It gives you a rigorous framework of language to understand of being in one situation, how do I get to another?
Thanks to Jane Street for supporting this episode. Now, Jane Street's a top research-based trading firm. It has offices all around the world, including New York, London, Hong Kong, Singapore, and Amsterdam. One of the reasons they support Numberphile, besides just loving math-based videos, is Jane Street hopes a few of you may end up working with them. Go to their website, click here on Join Jane Street to find out about all the great jobs, internships, and opportunities they have on offer. I visited one of their offices last week, and trust me, this is a place you'd really enjoy working. It was one of the most amazing workplaces I've ever seen. Go to janestreet.com, find out what's going on. If you do end up working there, hey, tell them Numberphile sent you.
Okay, and from this, what you get is a relation between time, a first interaction, and that's proportional to how far away you are from them, space is being x here, and their rate of diffusion.